This is my pleasure to give the talk, Yo-Yo Tricks with AES. And the authors are my former student Sondre Rønjum and Navid Bardi, my present PhD student, and myself, and I will give the talk. And what is Yo-Yo Tricks with AES? Well, I will tell you about this one, but first an outline. Essentially what we do is finding a new secret key distinguisher for AES for from 3 to 6 rounds, and in a new one for 5 rounds. And I will describe the main ideas. In particular, it's very nice the fact that you can distinguish 4 rounds of AES by 1 pair of plain text, knowing the ciphertext, modify it, and decrypt, and get the new plain text. And based on this, you can say AES or a random cipher. So this is a tech that works on substitution permutation networks. It basically will be on secret key distinguishers, and we will play the yo-yo game. So what is the substitution permutation network? Of course, you are quite familiar with this. You have the plain text and inner key, and then you take your bits into S-box, and then you do a permutation, linear permutation, or a fine permutation, and then you continue by adding the key, and you substitute your permutation in, like AES do this in 10 rounds. We work on a distinguisher attack that says, well, you have a block cipher here, and based on some kind of output, you have to decide, is this AES or is this a random cipher? So, the yo-yo game is the following. Actually, we call it a yo-yo game, but actually, this yo-yo game has been introduced by BM et al. Against Skipjack using a Feisel block cipher, and they had a question, how to do this on a SPN networks and like AES. And this is, in a sense, the problem we addressed in this paper. So what is the yo-yo game? In a way, you have a pair of plain text with some property or not the property. Then you can generate other pairs which has the same property by doing some exchange of words in their ciphertexts. And in a way, this is what we are doing. We have like a plain text, two plain text with a certain difference we are usually interested in. And we send the plain text in, and we get the ciphertext. And then based on the ciphertext, we do a new pair that we call a yo-yo pair that just interchange the bytes or the words in these two ciphertexts. And we get a new ciphertext, and we ask for the decryption of this, and we get a new pair of plain text. And some of the problems are, how do we select these input plain text, and how do we modify the output ciphertext, and how do we decide from the result of this decryption whether this is a yes or a random cipher. And actually, the yo-yo game is that we can go back here and we can do this many times around and around to get information. So, of course, the basic scenario here in this attack is the adaptively chosen cipher plaintext and ciphertext. Because every time we get a cipher text pair as a result of an encryption, we modify it and in our way, and we go back and modify this and continue until we have the information we need. And of course, we will look at the complexity estimates and show that this improves some of the existing AES distinguisher attacks and also peer recovery attacks. In a sense, we have like an S-box, and so in a way the state consists of and words. I mean, actually, if you look at AES, this one is like the first column, I mean like the word. You can consider this as the next column, third column, the fourth column. But you can do this in general for any SLS cipher or SLS cipher. And AES is like a special case of these two, of cipher. So in a sense, if you have this tape, you have an S-box that works on K bits, and then you use this on this K bit world, and then you get the big S-box, which is like the composition of this. And then you have the linear layer or affine layer. It doesn't have to be linear, affine is enough, and we consider these two situations. And because there is a representation of AES with using a super S-box, this SLS using the super S-box and the super linear layer and AES, this corresponds to four rods. And this will correspond similar to six rods. So in a way, the distinguisher attack actually works for all ciphers of this type in the first round and also in this situation, but then the generic situation, AES is easier than the generic situation. So, what is the yo-yo function? Well, if you have two states, alpha and beta, like to plain text or ciphertext, then you can interchange some bytes. So you make a new state, and in position I, you select alpha I if this primary vector is one in this I coordinate, and beta I otherwise. So this is what you do. And this has the property that if you add alpha plus beta, this will be the same as the new yo-yo pair sum. Because, I mean, when you construct this one here, you take the first byte, first word from alpha or beta. And then if you take the first word in here, and then the first word will go in here. What can also happen if you take the second word? You can put this in the second word in beta, and then the second word here will go in alpha. So you just exchange bytes. And you can do this in several different ways. It has also the nice property that if you look at the I's component, this is alpha I plus beta I. Of course, the same here because you just exchanged it. And if you do the S box, it will not change because in the I position, this will be the S box of alpha I plus the S box of beta I. Here you will just get the S box of this one, this is either alpha I or beta I, and this one, which is the other one. So you will order, so in a way the S box looks to be linear in the sense of this yo-yo pair. And of course, if you have a linear function here, on top of this one, you still have this property. You can just do bilinearity. This doesn't need any argument. So, one thing which is important is the zero difference pattern of two vectors. So if you have two vectors, you can look at a vector here, and the elements are like k-tuples, and you just define a binary vector which is one if this is zero. So it's like an indicator function for this zero, so for this one. Of course, for any permutation box, you have a trivial property also, that if alpha plus beta, if you look at this state here, if one position is zero, then if you do the S box, it will still be zero. Because if two positions in alpha and beta are the same before the S box, it will be the same afterwards because you have a permutation S-box. So, what now? This is like the situation we can sum up to. So, I think I had an example this is example of the yo-yo here. I just missed this slide. Maybe I do this. So, in a sense, if you have one state vector alpha like this and another beta like this, then you look at the vector here, every time it's zero, you take the beta part, and then if it's one, you take the alpha part, and then you take the beta part, and then in the other component, you just exchange beta and alpha, you just get the complementary. So in each component, you have either alpha or beta. You can just do this as you like. But you keep the sum, and you also keep this. If you do the S-box of this plus the S-box of this, it's the same as the S-box of this plus the S-box of this. So, then the situation is trivial. What do you do here? Well, take alpha plus beta. So this is a state, and you make a yo-yo pair for alpha and beta. So alpha prime is this one, and beta prime is just the one. So if you take alpha I component here, you take the from modified hearing that the beta confronteria and vice versa. And this means the following, that alpha plus beta is equal to the sum of the Euler pair. That was on the previous slide. If you compute SO alpha plus SO beta, it's still equal to the sum here. If you do the linear part here, you still by linearity. The next stage, you know, if you take an S box here, then things will not be equal anymore, but the zero set will be the same. Since this some of these are the same, it means that if two of these are equal, then they will be all equal in the same position there. So the zero set of this one, S and S, will be the same as this one. Because you have equality here, and then if this is zero, then this is zero, and the S box will preserve this. And this means that if you take a yo-yo pair, alpha beta, if you take alpha and beta and make a yo-yo pair, and do S and S, the set of zero positions in these two will be the same. And can you use this for cryptanalysis of SLS? Not really, but you can do it by doing this upside down. So what is your situation applying the yo-yo property? You take a plain text, P0 and P1. And actually, you want to make sure there's a lot of zeros here. So these are a lot of components which are the same. Then you do the S, L, S, and you get down to a ciphertext. So if somebody tells you this, then you make a yo-yo pair. And then, based on this yo-yo pair, you ask for the plain text pair. And what is the situation? Well, these two are yo-yo pairs. So if you do S, L, S, it works. But S is L, you just replace S. It works for any S, any L. So it works this way and this way. So it means that the zero set of this is equal to the zero set of this one. So, in any S, if you have a cipher like this one, if you put a lot of zeros in the two plain texts you select, they have a lot of zeros in position and maybe one or two non-zero, it means that if you ask for this one, you modify and you get this one, then this will have the same zeros. For a random cipher, that's extremely unlikely. And that means you can distinguish it. So it's a very, very elegant, a very simple idea for some reason has not really been noticed. You can extend this to the SLS in a certain sense. If you have an SLS cipher, and if you look at the D2 as SLS, you know that if you start with some P0 and P1, and you have a zero set at this stage of the SLS, the zero set is the same as here because the S doesn't affect this one. Then you can get the ciphertext and you can make a yo-yo pair. And even if you don't know the zero set of this one when you start, you know that when you do S inverse, L inverse, S inverse decryption, at this stage you will have the same zero set. And then you can go back here again and you can make a new yo-yo pair and go down here. S and S, and you will have the same zero set here. You can go down here, make a new yo-yo pair, and you will have the same zero set in the middle. So if you have a situation where you selected plain text, which has a certain zero sets here, even if you don't know what they are, but you may ruin something by selecting many pairs. And then you can construct a lot of pairs with the same probability. Now I will use it on AES, that you know what it looks like. We have the four basic constructions in the row, the subbytes, shift row, mixed column, and add key. So, if you want to do a distinguisher of four rows AES, if you write down four rows on AES, it looks something like this. For instance. So, and you can interchange the shift row and shift byte. And because you're interested in differences, add key doesn't really matter. So it means that this will look like, I mean, add key, and this doesn't really matter either. Because if you know the difference before here, this doesn't matter, and the shift row. And in a way, so you can start here, and this is the SLS with these values. So this works on the columns of AES state. So in a way, this is the situation. So in a way, you just have to look at this situation so when you start. Because, so what do you do? Well, you select the two plain texts so that they look like this with input there. In a way, it means they have to be like a diagonal because of the shift law, but I don't care about these things. So they are zero in all these 96 bits, and non-zero in here. And then if you do SLS, you get the cipher, and then you construct the yo-yo pair, and then you go back, and then you have to compare whether this has exactly the same 69 zero bits. If not, this is a random cipher, otherwise it's AES. So the probability that this fail is 2 to the minus 96. So this is basically zero. This will always work. And what you have to do is almost nothing, just the XOR. You can do a yo-yo distinguisher for 5 rounds of AES. In a similar way, you can write it as like a 4 rounds part, and then you can have like an extra operation in front, nobody remove some linear functions before it. And after. So this dealt with sub-bytes. So in a sense, if you have a plain text here, so then you can do the sub-byte with, so you select a pair of plain text which is only non-zero in the first column. And then you do the sub-byte, will not change the situation, and then you do the mixed columns. And in this case, these three will not are already the same, so the difference will still be zero. But you may assume that you may want the situation that you have two zero bytes in your first column after the mixed column. This goes once the code goes away where it sits, so you actually know how often this will happen. So if you select sufficient, the probability of this is like 4 over t times 2 to the minus 16 essentially. So this would be like 2 to the 13 is the probability that you will have this situation. So if you have 2 to the 13 of these pairs, you will expect this to happen. So, and then after shift row, you will still, this will be shift there, so you have two columns which are zero. So the zero set is here. And then you have this SLS, so you go down to the ciphertext here. And then if you make a yo-yo pair here, you go up again here, and you know that there will be two zeros here because of this zero pattern will be preserved. And in this case, after the shift row, you will have two zeros in each column. And then, because of the mixed column, you will have at most one zero here. Because the weight is 5, or it could happen that both of these bytes are zero when they come from here. So this has a probability like 2 to 11, so about 2 to 11 here. So in a sense, if you have like a random situation, you will just test whether you have. If you have at least two zeros here, that's not possible for the AES situation for this world. But for the random situation, this will happen after about 2 to 11 tests. So you make a lot of pairs, 2 to 13 pairs, and then you test each of them, and you go down and test whether you have two zeros here. In this case, you go to the next pair. Otherwise, you make a new yo-yo pair, and you just test this, and as soon as you get two zeros there, you go to the next possible pair. And in this sense, you will get rid of, if this is a random cipher, you will get rid of all possibilities by testing about 2 to the 11 for each of these, like 2 to the 13 possibilities. So in the sense, this will give like a complexity of 2 to the 25. If this is AES, this situation here that you can expect means that when you go around here, you have at most one zero here. So this pair will, so in a way you need 2 to the 40 pairs to find something else in the way. So you can actually use this to find whether this is A as a group. So the attack is just select so many pairs and do the yo-yo, and every time you get two zeros here, you throw away the pair and you continue for getting rid of all 2 to the 13 pair. If it's AES, you have a pair that will survive in a sense. So in a way, this is the five And this is like the complexity 2 to the 25, which is so many pairs you need to find like the right pair here, and so many for eliminating. And then you can do similar for the 6 of AES. Then you do the similar. You can start with the situation. For 6 row, it's same as this one using the super S box. And then you can make something with 4 different curves here. And you can do an S part, and you can hope for this pattern here. And you can compute the probability of this pattern. And when you found this, and because of the S, because of the mixed column, the sum of this non-zero verse would be 5. This is actually from the proof. This is just not the sum of S boxes, but this is also true for the super S boxes in this case. And then you continue here, and you can do making these type of yo-yo pairs. And actually, if you just have one of these one, it means that when you got up here, you have 3 zeros here. And so all of these columns has to be non-zero. So the probability of a zero column, if you have a zero column here, you can just throw it away. But this will not happen for the AES case, because you have already 3. Yeah. So in a sense, the complexity for this attack is 2 to the 122 additive chosen ciphertext. So this is the data complexity for TS2. You can also do it for TS1, but then it's slightly better. But this is better than complete search, but not very much. So this attack has not been implemented, but all the other attacks have been. And actually, one of the referees implemented the attack. So in a way, this is like the situation. You can also have like a 4 on key recovery attack, and this is slightly different. So you select pairs of plain text, so are identical in 3 of the words as usual, but the first word, it looks like this one in one of them, and the first column in the other one is like this for some known C, and then the I runs through everything, and you can do some partial encryption because now we are looking for the key before the first key. And if you do these calculations here, you can show that there actually are 2 possibilities. There are 2 possible solutions. 2 of these plain text for I will have a 0 in the third position. So this means that if you look at this one, you start with something here, and then you do the zeros in these positions, and you will have at least 1 zero here in one of these 2 to the 28. And if you have this situation, it means that this will give you a zero column here. And because of the SLS here, you have the same zero set here, a zero column here. And after this one, you have 1 zero in each of them. And actually, so you can test all possible keys in the first column. And then you can test, you can ask for this one, and you can test whether this will give a zero column here. And you can do this for like 5 pairs to make sure since you have 2 to the 24 possible keys that you are looking for, that you don't know. You have one relation that you know I, which is related to the key. So it means that if you do this, you can get a tag that needs the complexity 2 to the 11 over 3. So in a way, this is like 2 to the 8 pairs of plain text. So that 2 to the 8 times 2. And then you do it for 5 pairs here, and you just test this one. And this will work. And you can compare with the existing secret key distinguisher. So for 3 rounds, the yo-yo attack here is 3 adaptively chosen ciphertext and 2 XORs, so it's better than the previous one. If you do it for 4, actually 3 rounds I didn't do, but we also did it's trivial to be slightly simpler than the 4 rounds. It cannot be much simpler than the 4 rounds, but it's a little bit better. And then you do the for the 5 rounds, you have this one, which is quite better than the previous one. The 6 round is like this one, and this didn't really exist. I think 5 rounds is quite new, maybe last a year or 2 or And if you look at the comparison for the file recovery, we only did the file recovery for 5 rounds. We have the data 2 to 11, like this one, and the computation corresponds to 2 to 31 5-round encryptions. And then the memory is quite small. So in a way, these very simple techniques give a surprisingly improvement of 4 rounds. We're still struggling to improve or beyond 6 rounds. That would be nice to do. And but of course, you cannot beat all record in the first paper. So there are probably a lot of people that can improve on this thing. But the idea is really, I like the idea. And of course, the main idea comes from my student, Sondre. He was a smart student. He did his thesis on stream cipher, but also on block cipher. He has good ideas. And I think this is pretty much my talk. So this is what I did. Yo-yo games from 3 to 6 rounds, and repeat all the records on these 3, 4, 5, and 6 rounds, and we need a key recovery on 5 rounds. And one of them improves the record, and of course gives us a lot of open problems. But still, it's this is what I wanted to say. That simple things can improve the text. So thank you.
I'm not sure about your notation. When you are in your 4x4 matrices, when you have white, it means zero difference. When you have gray, it means definitely non-zero, or it could be anything.
Because gray, it can be anything, yeah.
Could be anything.
Could be anything. Yeah, that could also be, yeah, it could also be some zeros, but not all for the, it depends on the attack, yeah.
Thanks.
One question? Have you considered any application to the key recovery attack
of AES on this distinction? No, not yet. We are looking at other potential block ciphers to see if we can use the same CU technique, but maybe it needs to be modified. But it's still interesting to do. And we also would like to, of course, improve the 6 rounds would be nice to improve, because that is so simple and stupid. It's very naive, but it works. So maybe a more sophisticated will give an improvement. And of course, beyond 6 will be really nice too, because it's amazingly well it performs in the lower 3 to 6 rounds.
Any more question?
Have you considered the false positive probability?
The first?
Success probability. You discard the random permutation as the AES.
Yeah. 6 round AES.
What's the probability?
If you look at the paper, you can see what it's what's there. Well, yeah, I think. Yeah.
One question? No, let's speak again.